Java is a C-style language. That means it shares syntax with C, C++, and other similar languages, but it has its own unique set of rules. First of all Java code is defined in classes. A class is defined in a source code file with a .java file extension. In order to turn that file into bytecode, you use the Java C command. That's the compiler. And then the bytecode can be run on top of the Java virtual machine. You start the virtual machine with the Java command. Here's what a simple class looks like. The first line is called the package declaration. This indicates where the file is stored in terms of the directory structure of the application, but it's also a tool for organizing your code. Next is the class declaration. There might be other lines between the package and the class depending on the needs of your code. The class declaration can start with an access modifier such as public, private, or protected, but then must have the class keyword. The name of the class comes next, followed by a code block. Everything within the code block is said to be a member of the class. This is called a method. In non-object-oriented languages, you might refer to this as a function. It's a way of encapsulating code that you can run. In this example, I'm starting with the keyword public. That's the access modifier. Static, which means you don't need to create an instance of the main class in order to run this method. Void, which means that the class doesn't return anything, and then the name of the method. Within the parentheses, you define parameters. These parameters are designed to receive data as the method is called. The main method is defined strictly in command line applications as the method that's executed automatically when you start up the class, and it always receives an array of string values. Finally, you have your executable code. This main method only has one line of code, but you can actually have as many as you want. So this is a simple but well-formed class that will run successfully on the Java virtual machine. You can also test your Java code in JShell, a command you can run from terminal on Mac or from a command window on other operating systems. JShell was introduced with Java 9, and it lets you just test your code before you take that code and put it into a fully formed class. In JShell, you don't need a complete class. You can just execute one line of code at a time, and then you can take that code that you've tested and save it out to a file so you can convert it to production code. In Java, everything is case sensitive. So your identifiers, such as variable, method, and class names, all need to be unique within their particular scopes. Because of this case sensitivity, the following are different identifiers from the Java point of view. They all say first name, but the first one is lowercase, the second one uses camel case, and the third is all uppercase. These are each seen as unique. Java in general is not sensitive to whitespace. That is to say, extra whitespace doesn't affect how your code is interpreted or compiled. And in fact, if you put in extra spaces, tabs, or line feeds, those will be collapsed by the compiler. Let's say you have 5 line feeds. From a compilation point of view, that's the same as 1 line feed. In order for this to work, all statements in Java must end with a semicolon character. So for example, this is a bit of code that outputs a string, "Hello from Java," to the console. And because it's a single statement, it ends with that semicolon character. If you're working on a full-blown class and you forget the semicolon, it'll cause a compilation error. If you run this same command, though, in JShell, it'll work fine without the semicolon, because semicolons aren't really needed in JShell, or, to put it more accurately, they're added automatically for you in the background. There are some very strong conventions that are used by all Java developers, and you should follow these conventions. First of all, there's an absolute requirement that all identifiers must start with either an alphabetical character, A through Z, or an underscore character. You can't use numbers as the first character in an identifier. You also can't use keywords as identifiers. You can find a comprehensive list of Java keywords up through Java 8 at this web page, and then you can look at the documentation for more recent versions of Java to find out what keywords have been added since then. There are some very strong conventions for creating your identifiers. Class names always start with an uppercase character, but then use mixed case for the rest of the class name. Methods and variables always have names that start with a lowercase character. So when you look at an identifier, you can distinguish between a class name and, say, a method name or a variable name. Constants are an interesting situation with Java. There isn't really any such thing as a pure constant in Java. That is, there isn't a keyword such as const. Instead, in order to define a value that never changes, you start with the keywords public, static, and final, and then the data type, string in this case, and then the identifier. Constant identifiers are always spelled in all uppercase. Now, all of these are just conventions. You could do it differently if you wanted to, but it's a great idea to follow the conventions that have been established and are followed broadly within the Java development community. Finally, I mentioned code blocks. A code block is defined by a pair of braces. This is a way of organizing your code, but it's also a way of restricting visibility of variables. When you declare a variable within a code block, it's only visible and useful within that code block, and it expires and is eligible for garbage collection once the code block is complete. You'll see code blocks used extensively with method implementations. Every method has a code block, and the code within the block is the executable code for that method, and loops usually use code blocks as well. So whatever code is within the block associated with a loop will get executed as many times as necessary to satisfy the requirements of the loop.